Okay, let's now go to summative assessment kasi gustong-gusto natin yung summative assessment, no? Noong mga unang panahon, no, ito yung mga katumbas ng ating mga written and performance tasks, even quarterly exams. Naalala nyo nung high school pa tayo, guys, yung mga periodical tests, no? And even yung mga ewan ko kung merong mga exit exams ang school ninyo, parang gano'n, para i-promote kayo to the next level, mga gano'n. Pero here, we focus on the written and the performance task. So anong sinasabi ng policy guidelines sa summative assessment? So these are assessments usually administered towards the end, no, pagpatapos na. No, patapos na lang ang term or ang klase, papahirap ka muna bago ka matapos. Meron ka muna ng exam, di ba? And it measures the extent of which the learners have mastered the essential learning competencies, and the results are recorded and are used to report. Ito na yung may card, no? Kung 97 ka sa math, mga ganyan. Ito na, this form part of that. Okay? So, di ba, nung mga bata tayo, after na, pag na-release yung card, tanungan, nakailan ka sa ganito? Di ba, yung gano'ng mga bata? And we often compare because we think that these grades really do matter. And they do, no? They do in the context of our society now. Pero, pag-isipan din natin, ano? Pag-isipan din natin ang new normal and post-COVID world, no? Okay. Ngayon, sabi sa policy, to evaluate student learning at particular points in each quarter, summative assessment shall continue. Take note, but in the form of written works and performance tasks. And if you read through the other documents, they forgo the delivery or, you know, having or administering quarterly exams. Hindi na sila nag-periodical exam. Okay? So, pag-usapan natin yung dalawa, yung written works and performance tasks. So, first, written works. What are these? These are quizzes, long exams, similar forms, distributed across cognitive process dimensions. Ang social na, ano? Cognitive process dimensions. So, sabi niyo po, sir, mahirap magpa-quiz, magpa-long exam. Eh, bakit sinasabi pa rin natin to? Ibig sabihin, mag-iisip po tayo ng paraan. Okay, before I go to that, ang sabi doon, pag nagpa-exam ka, you distribute it across the cognitive process dimensions. Of course, we are all familiar with the revised Bloom's taxonomy, which now looks into, you know, remember, understand, apply, analyze, evaluate, and to create. No, these are now the taxonomy of the words that we use to create our objectives. At the same time, inspire and align us to create assessments and activities. Ayun. So, ibig sabihin, pag nagpa-exam ako, puro lang ba remembering? Dapat hindi, di ba? Dapat may understanding, may analyzing, and so on and so forth. So, you distribute across the cognitive process dimensions. And challenge natin sa sarili natin, wag lang cognitive process dimensions, let's also align this with what we refer to as knowledge dimensions. These are factual, conceptual, procedural, and metacognitive dimensions. So ito, I love this article from the Iowa State University on how they actually interface the cognitive process dimensions with the knowledge dimension. Tingnan nyo, kunwari sa remember, yung exam ko pang remember, pero gusto ko metacognitive, it's now identify. The questions will be on the identify set. If I want them to apply and I would want to go to procedural, I want them to carry out procedures or processes. So it's actually a good guide. No? It's actually a good guide and a good opportunity for teachers to review. Hindi lang basta gumawa ka ng exam. No? Remember, we have to distribute across cognitive process dimensions. And my challenge to everybody to include knowledge dimensions. Okay. Let's ipapatuloy natin, ano? So, dito naman kanina written work, ngayon performance task. Ito yung mas mahalaga para sa akin. Ito yung nakikita ko mas mahalaga. So, these are ways for our students to create, innovate products, or do performance-based tasks like skill demos, presentations, oral work, and research projects. Diba? Walang exam, pero may gagawin, no? Which actually show the achievement of learning competencies and of course, harmonization of these competencies. Okay. Of course, when you talk about performance-based assessments, we cannot shy away or distance ourselves from project and problem-based learning, di ba? Alam na, naririnig natin lagi yan eh. When we talk about STEM education, we will talk about problem and project-based learning, right? So, if you notice, yung naka-red, why did I place this in red? Because they are much related to our talk today. So, PBL, serves as formative, performance-based, and authentic forms of evaluations. And they allow for co-assessing of learning. Okay, very important. Now, nabanggit ko kanina, I've mentioned that we don't have quarterly exams, but the time that you use for exams can be used for their presentations of their performance tasks, which essentially show how the performance standards in the CGs are actually manifested in our students as outcomes. Pakita ko lang, no? I'll just scan through some. Ito po, number one, conduct a survey to assess the possible geologic hazards your community may experience. Dito sa Earth and Life ng grade 11 or 12. Diba? Actually, dalawa yan na magkatulad pagdating sa paputang lesson 10, hydrometeorological hazards naman. So, pwede ba itong gawin ng bata kahit naka-community quarantine? Pwede. Pwede namang di sila lumabas ng bahay. Pwede silang gumamit ng hazard hunter. Pwede silang gumamit ng Google Earth. Pakita ko to guys ha. Hazard Hunter PH, for example, nilocate ko po ang Manila City Hall. Ayan, sa Hazard Hunter. Ito po yun. Ngayon, pag kinlik mo po ito sa, ang kinlik ko po yung hydrometeorological hazard kasi wala naman pong volcanic hazard dito sa ano, for now. No? So kinlik ko po yung flood. Ayan po. At ito po yung lumabas. Yung mas dark color po, ibig sabihin mas ano po siya, no? Mas may risk sa flooding. Tapos ito po yung lumabas, no, sabi ng MGB, no, susceptibility po ng areas na to for flooding, moderate susceptibility. Nakabigay naman po na more or less 1 meter na flood, ganyan. So, ibig sabihin, pwedeng gamitin to ng bata, type lang nila yung location nila, ma-assess nila or masusurvey nila yung hazards sa place nila. And you can even ask them to plan mitigation or DRRM measures, di ba? You can even ask them to create a presentation to their barangay captain, no? Talking about the risks for example, for geohazards and of course, for hydrometeo hazards. Sa Bicol, we experience all, di ba? All the hazards. Tagbagyo tayo, no? Ang vulkan, and so on and so forth. So we are very resilient in all of these hazards. So dapat ba alam natin to? Yes. Yes, we have to. Diba? Yun, no? Okay. But hindi ko na didiscuss yung iba, guys, no? So, pero pinapakita ko yung mga halimbawa, no? So, eto, papunta na ako sa last part ng talk. Mahalaga yung rubric, no? Kasi performance activity siya. Hindi pwedeng nag-perform yung bata, okay, 10, okay, 97. The child should know why, no? Why? You often need to tell them the rubric before they do the activity, no? They have to know how they will be assessed. That is just right. In my classes often, I introduce the rubric so that they can give me a comment. Sir, parang gusto na yung bawasan yung ganitong indicator, gawin na lang natin ganito. They participate in that. I even ask them, okay lang ba sa inyo self-assessment is 10%? I even ask them that. That has to be part of what you talk about in class because that is a learning contract. Diba? When you introduce the course, you are creating a contract with your learners. Now, so these are rubrics, holistic, analytical, and then these are sample rubrics for investigations. Okay? Mahalaga na ma-force natin ang mga bata, no, na maintindihan nila na they need to investigate, innovate, and create. No? Writing good hypotheses, good problems, going through processes, and so on. Of course, the paper that they submit becomes something that we need to rate or grade. No? Ito, example na ginagamit po namin for problem-based or project-based learning activities. So there are criteria and there's the description. Pag napasok sa description, automatic 4 and so on. And I would like to highlight, you notice that we have these formative and summative learning experiences, no, or strategies. And I think we cannot say na hindi important yung summative, no? It's also very important. But during the time of the pandemic, we have to really beef up, no, on this formative forms of assessment because it's really hard, no, mahirap yung sitwasyon. No, they really need to know that they're doing good, they're not doing very well, where do they need to, you know, improve and so on. Such that there is a shift to what we refer to as assessment for learning or for that formative concept of assessment. Okay, if you notice, there are fewer exams, but more doing, no? More actions, more performance, more research, and so on. Now, I'm almost to the end, no, of this presentation, guys. Thank you for sticking around. Now, for me, the best assessment is three things. Number one, it is a reflection of your goals. What do you want them to learn? So the assessment should reflect that. If you want them to derive the speed of light, then create an assessment that they will be able to show that. It is a combination of various types. There are a lot of ways to assess. I've mentioned some of them. Those are not, they may not be the best, no? But these are some examples. I know you can have a host of a lot of things that you can share. And finally, contextualize. We have to contextualize assessments. Because like what I said, teaching and learning nowadays is a case-to-case basis. Some of my learners are, you know, are not always active in the synchronous sessions because of internet issues and so on and so forth. Now, ways forward. Anong gusto kong sabihin? Number one, assessment for learning. Gamitin natin ang assessment para matuto. Mas mahalaga yon. Pangalawa, inclusive and diverse forms of assessment. Hindi lahat ng bata pare-parehas ng sitwasyon, pinagdadaanan. Di ba? Like in the ESTA framework, our learners are diverse. Culturally, in language, in geopolitics, and so on and so forth. Even economy. So their capacities and affordances also differ, no? Kaya nga sabi ko kanina, 'di ba, pag nagtanong sa klase, you have to be sure everyone can answer, meaning has the capacity to answer. Eh hindi yung mag-identify ka na lang. Flexibility in assessment. Let's be more flexible this time. Self and peer, 'di ba? 'Di ba ang saya pag sinabi ko na inassess ko yung sarili ko, ay 8 lang po ako overnight, pero inassess ako ni sir na perfect. Yung mga ganon, bakit kaya ni sir inassess na perfect yung output ko? Tapos bakit kaya ako nag-assess lang na mas mababa? It's actually allowing the learners to think. Performance-based, guys. More performance-based. No? Kung sinabi mo gusto mo silang magsulat ng tula, o di magsulat ng tula. Kung sinabi mo gusto mo silang magtula or tumula, eh di dapat tumutula sila. Diba? The performance is very important. And eto last na, integrative forms of assessment. Napakarami at napakakapal minsan ng mga ginagawa ng mga bata. Baka pwede naman tayo mag-usap-usap na baka yung assessment natin pwede nating i-harmonize. Sa PNU, for example, yung course na tinuturo naming Science, Technology, and Society, kina-harmonize namin sa purposive communication. Kaya yung isang requirement on writing a position paper on climate change na submit ng bata, hindi lang sa isang subject, sa dalawang subject. Diba ang ganda nun, nakabawas sa trabaho ng bata? Kasi parehas lang naman ang gusto kayong mangyari. Ako, I want to know the position of that child as to climate change. The English teacher would like to know kung paano siya magsulat, di ba? So, maybe we can have integrative forms of assessment. I know integrative forms of assessment would merit another talk, no? Napakalaki din itong pag-uusap, no? Pero baka pwede naman tayo mag-usap-usap. Hindi porque maraming tinuro, maraming in-assess, maganda yung teaching and learning, dapat appropriate and essential. Okay? Tanungin ko lang bago ako matapos. I want all of our teachers to reflect. With all things that we did already and we are doing, do you think we are learner-centered? Kasi that is what we front. We are always saying we are learner-centered. Are we really learner-centered or are we concerned more on the content? Mas mahalaga ba yung natututunan o yung tinuturo? Alin yung mas mahalaga? Pag-isipan po natin, mga guro. Pero bago ako matapos, I have a request. Kasi yung fields I have, may advocacy sila, di ba, on STEAM and STEM education. May request po ako sa inyo because we are part of STEM education. Please tell your learners that they can be STEM professionals and STEM teachers. Please tell them that they can be one of us. Okay? So that we can better the quality of STEM education in the Philippines and we can increase the number of STEM professionals in the Philippines.